Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Dear students, Assalamu alaikum. This is the third lecture on the topic in this course, Translation and Cultural Studies. And as you know, we are discussing the concept of culture, and this is the second part of the presentation. I hope you remember that we have so far discussed six characteristics of culture, namely, I hope you will find them, they are there. We have discussed culture is manifested at different layers of depths. Culture affects behavior and interpretations of behavior. Culture differentiating between, we should be able to put, line or, distinction between culture, universal human nature, and unique individual personality. Number four, culture influences biological processes. Number five, culture is associated with social groups. And number six, culture is both an individual, culture is both an individual construct and a social construct. So we have discussed these six characteristics in the previous lecture. Today we are going to discuss the next remaining six, and they are: culture is socially and psychologically distributed in a group. Number eight, culture has both universal, that is ethic, and distinctive elements, that is emic. Number nine, culture is learned. Number 10, culture is subject to gradual change. Number 11 is the various parts of the cultures are to some degree interrelated. And 12 and last is culture is a descriptive, not an evaluative concept. So let's start from number 7. Let me go to number 7 on the slide. Here it is. Culture is socially and psychologically distributed in a group. Because it is distributed, in one group, socially and psychologically, hence a description of a culture features will always be fuzzy. Drawing clear lines between what is cultural specific or what is not cultural specific is always very fuzzy, is difficult or confusing. In other words, we can say there are always gray areas between these lines. We can also take the example of family resemblances. We know that the family members, of course, they are siblings and brothers, but yet they have differences among themselves. We call them one family at the same time. Apart from these differences, although we try to differentiate, we try to mention or describe these differences among the family members, among the brothers or brothers and sisters, we try to do that, but in the end, as a whole, we call them a family. In this way, we can say this is a Pakistani culture. But Pakistani culture itself, or Punjabi culture, or Pakhtun culture, or Balochi culture, Sindhi culture, and so on, we can say socially and psychologically distributed in that particular group. Let's discuss these two very important terminologies used in the area. Number one is sociogenic. Sociogenic means individual differences within that group. Let's take example of Punjabi culture. We call that Punjabi culture, but there are individual differences there. Some people they do not follow the culture the way other people follow that culture. A group, there are varieties. I think the word variety is the more relevant to this concept, is sociogenic, that varieties are available, although we can call that Punjabi culture. Psychogenic is a term which is which is indicative to the fact that one, take the example of one individual in a cultural group, Punjabi culture, and there are values in that culture. There are things that culturally very sacred and people respect those things, but that individual A or individual B or individual C or individual D and so on, the whole individuals in that particular culture, they have different motivation for these values. Let's suppose there are 10 values, values related to clothing, values related to how to behave with the kids, values related to when and with whom should we eat and what should we eat. So we see that there are differences always, because maybe values of clothing is very much respected by Mr. A, individual A, but is not very much respected by Mr. B. So we can, this is called psychogenic, in that sense we say that the experts in this area of cultural studies, they say culture is socially and psychologically distributed in a group. So in nutshell, in when we want to sum it up, we can use the varieties. So there are varieties, even then we call that is one culture, as I said, Punjabi culture, Pakistani culture, and so on. Number 8, the culture has both universal and distinctive elements. For that, the two terms are used in this area. Number 1 is attic, which is used for the universal, and the second one is amic, which is used for distinctive, specific, local elements. Interestingly, these two terms have been taken from linguistics and from phonetics generally. You see the word phonetic, so attic, the last syllable of the word phonetic, attic, has been derived from that phonetic, because the phonetic in linguistics means the study of sounds in all human languages. This is universal, study of sounds, basic sounds in all human languages, whereas amic has been taken as a last syllable from the word phonemic, and phonemic is the branch of phonetics, which branch of linguistics and phonetics also, which studies the sounds of a specific language. So phonetic, general study of the sounds in all the human languages, and phonemic, study of sounds in particular language, let's say Arabic, English, Urdu, Chinese, and other human languages. So the culture has both elements, is attic and amic, or universal or distinctive. As for the attic, we can say the overlapping biologies living in fairly similar social structure or physical environments, we can call them the attic. The examples of attic, we can say that every nation, every culture have the concept of respect for elders. Take this example. This is attic part of the culture. And be with me in this example, because this is very important. Respect for elders in almost all the cultures, in human cultures, in the known history. But this is attic part of this cultural value, universal. Universally, no one disagrees with that the elders should be taken care, that the elders should be respected, that the elders, so on and so forth, religiously and socially as well, which in the end, become a cultural value. In the same value, the implementation of this value differs in different cultures. Respect for elders in the primitive cultures or in a Pakistani culture is different. The concept was different. I am using the word was, maybe still in some areas, that when you sit in front of your elders, you do not see them, you do not have eye contact with them. The behind
The core value is that you respect the elders, Attic part. But how do you implement that value in a specific culture? That is that you, when you sit in front of your parents, your elders, you do not have eye contact with them, or you talk to them with a very polite words, polite sounds, words that are used in that particular situation. Example, Muslim culture, examples, Pakistani culture, example, maybe Asian cultures in general. But with the same ethic value, that is respect for elders, if you go to some Western culture right now in this era, you find that although they have this, but their emic part is that when they implement this, they would be having they would have eye contact with the elders, with their parents, and even they would have a different way of talking to their elders. And when the Pakistani, when we come back to the Pakistani culture, the emic is that we do this in a particular way. So in this one example, we see the attic part, which is universal, which is reflected in the respect for the elders. But the emic part is how do we implement that value in a specific culture. As for the biological living in a fairly similar social structure, but the physical environments, there are a lot of examples that can be discussed. I think one example, keep this example in your mind as for the attic and emic, part of the culture. The remaining slide is, I hope, clear, because I have discussed with the before that. Now we can move on to the next characteristic of the culture. It is, culture is learned. It's very strange. In the history of cultural studies or anthropology, the researchers believe that the culture is maybe a part of the genes, or the culture is one is born with a certain culture. But after doing scientific research, they have discovered that the culture is a phenomenon which is acquired, which is learned from the whole environment. And they have conducted a lot of experiments to prove that. How the culture is learned, or how the culture is just like language. A language is part of the culture. A baby born in a specific language speaking people would learn the same language. Suppose a baby originally from Chinese families, but the baby was born in a Pakistani city and brought up in that culture, he would be using Urdu or that local language where he was born or brought up. So the culture is just same like the language. So it is learned from the people you interact with them. It is our daily observation that we also learn some values when we interact with the people. But basically, the culture is transmitted from adults to the youngsters, from parents to the kids, from elders to their children, and so on. This is one big way of transmission of culture or learning of culture in a particular group. And it is also learned through explanations, because the elders, they explain a lot of things to their kids and children, why it is important, why doing a thing in a certain way is good in that culture, in the culture that we are living in, and they give some interpretations, some explanations to that. I would like to link this with one of the cultural characteristics, or the characteristics of the culture we have discussed earlier, and it was like this one, where we see that these three,
these three levels or things that are core characteristics of the culture, that there are artifacts, that are artifacts, number one,
and creations, visible and audible behavior and so on and so forth, and then underlying values behind these attitudes, behaviors, and patterns and so on, technology, things that we use, the way we live, the way we, our whole life. But behind them there are values, and then underlying basic assumptions are also there.
If you relate this, the point that we are discussing here in number 9, you would be better do explanations.
So if I'm wearing a shalwar kameez, if I'm not wearing a pant or shirt or vice versa, maybe I need to explain this to my kids why I'm doing that in certain situation. The smile at strangers, in some of the cultures, people teach their children to be smiley all the time, even at the strangers when they meet them. But in other culture, might be in our society, where we have we teach our kids to only smile to specific situations and not smile to the strangers. The cultural surrounding is such. The whole cultural surrounding is telling us, the elders, to teach their children that behave in a certain way. And also, explanation takes place, and we say this is good or this is bad, or this good person characteristics are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and bad persons are characteristics are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Even sometimes we also explain to the kids that the appearance of the good person is this. I don't want to give you the tangible things, but you can imagine. Or appearance of the bad person is this and not that. When the kids crying in front of the guests, or not crying in front of, be quiet when there are guests, because we tend to be very formal. Or be you the way you are, be informal the way you are, being quiet or being talkative, and so on so forth. So all these things are learned and acquired within one society. In the American society, the culture suggests that the children from their childhood, they should take their own decisions. They encourage they teach their children to take their own decisions and then take the responsibility of that decision. If the decision is good, you feel proud of that, you feel that you have achieved something. And if the decision goes wrong, you take the responsibility of that decision. On the other hand, in our Asian culture, in our Muslim culture, I think we pamper our kids and we take care of them, even if they become grown up. Even then, our culture does not allow us to give them this freedom to take their own decisions and take the responsibility of their own decision. Huge cultural differences are taken, are learned, and are acquired from these two cultural settings. I'm comparing with the Western model and the Asian or Muslim model, where this thing is happening, and so on. You can imagine other things that take place in a specific culture. With this, we can move on to number 10, my dear student, is culture is subject to gradual change. I think there's a famous saying that the change is the only constant thing in the universe is change. So everything is changing. It's I think obvious, very obvious. We don't need to explain it more than this. The culture is a snapshot view of one particular time. The time is very important in this, because if we go back 100 years, Pakistani territory, that was the part of the subcontinent, 100 years ago the culture was different, and now the culture values have changed tremendously, especially in the big cities and even in the rural areas as well. There are a lot of changes happening. So the snap shot, as if you are taking a picture of that, but maybe after 1 year that picture does not stand valid, because a lot of changes would have taken place cultural setting. No culture remains completely static year after year. Of course, the example, huge examples can be seen around us. We are matured students, rather we are researchers. You are also researchers now, so you can also observe this in even take the history of this university. This university's history is not very long. It started in 1985 formally as an international Islamic university, and now we can say how many years have passed, 35 years. So during these 35 years, the university has changed. Even the last 2 years, now there are a lot of changes, although we are unable to observe them clearly. These changes, these are actually cultural changes. Anyways, what are the forces of change that lead to what we are talking about? Number one is internal, and then number two is the external force. There are two forces that cause changes in a particular culture. The internal changes usually take place because of discovery and invention. When people get more education, when they conduct researches, when they discover natural phenomena, or when they invent something, the cultural changes follow in that particular society. But researchers tell us that the most of the changes, cultural changes, take place because of the external factors. What is that external? What are those external factors? They are borrowing from other cultures, and they call them cultural diffusion. And they say most of the cultural changes in any society, they are caused by cultural diffusion or external borrowing. And they say 90% of the cultural changes have taken place and are taking because of this external. Why? And they answer to this question, they say, because the doing your research by your own self is very difficult. It is time taking, and you need to work very hard so that you reach some discovery or so that you invent something. So it is very easy to copy things, borrow things, you ready things from other societies, from other cultures. And that is the obvious reason for this 90% figure that we see for bringing as a cause of change in a culture. And they have also studied the regularities of diffusion, and for that they have given us some regularities, that the diffusion regularity, borrowing regularities. They say this diffusion process is a selective process. A borrowing process, taking from other culture, is a diffusion process, is a selective process. It is based on two things: whether the thing that we are taking is useful for that particular culture, or is it compatible to that particular culture. And then they have found five conditions for that, and they say selective processes, it is seen to be superior to what already exists. Borrowing takes place when that particular value, innovation, discovery or invention is superior to what already exists. Suppose we don't have TV in our culture, and TV is invented in another culture. So the TV is seen as a useful and a compatible to some extent. So it means that it is superior to what already exists in our culture. So we don't have, and they have invented TV, another culture. So the possibility that we would adopt that in our culture. Number two, it is consistent with existing cultural patterns. TV is taken, and I remember when the TV was taken, there was a huge hot debate, and you will find this debate in other areas, you know, other areas of technology. And the mobile phones, you know, still there are people, they object the use of mobile, but even then it is not consistent with existing cultural pattern, but it is being adopted with the alteration, with some supervision, with some monitoring, with some instructions, with some checks that are there in the whole society. Number three, it is easily understood. So the possibility is that this thing would be taken. Number four, it is able to be tested on experimental basis. It can be used easily, number four. And also it can be tested on experimental basis. When you do the experiment and you see that this is useful for us, so it is, the possibility is that we would adopt it. Number five, its benefits are clearly visible to a relatively large number of people in that society. This last condition is answer to many questions that may arise when we see condition number two and condition number three, because you know it's largely, we see the ratio, whether adopting this innovation, whether adopting this device, whether adopting this cultural item, we see that it's clearly visible to a relatively large number of people in that society. It's beneficial, large number, and hence adopted. Number two is the in cultural diffusion, or regularities of cultural diffusion, is cultural borrowing is a two-way process. It doesn't mean that the strong, we only take things from the strong cultures, let's say the developed culture of the developed countries, and we adopt their values only. We also give some thing to those developed societies as well. So it's a two-way process. Although the percentage of what we take is more than the percentage of what the developed countries take from us. There are a few examples. European contact with the original Americans, when it took place in the history, we see that the Europeans, although they abolished the old Indian Americans in Americas, but they adopted also a lot of things from their culture. Like, take the example of these crops, like corn, beans, squash, sweet potatoes, and other things. Number three is the borrowed items taken after adaptation. And the example is that pizza. Take the Italian word is pizza, and the pizza, you know, is basically an Italian food dish. But now we see when it is not prepared in Pakistan, is not Italian pizza, even in America, although region was that. So there are a lot of adaptation, a lot of slight changes that the way we try to incorporate our own traditional ways of cooking something, and then we call that the same way the pizza. And the Chinese as well, there can be Indian food in Western countries, and they are not like the Pakistani food or Indian foods that we talk about. The fourth regulation of diffusion is that some cultural traits are more easily diffused than others, like technological innovations versus social patterns or belief systems. Technological innovations are borrowed or diffused very easily from one culture to other, because they are always taken an addition to that culture, or beneficial to that culture, or they are very useful for that culture. On the other hand, social patterns or social beliefs or customs are very hard. It's very, very rare that article, although they are also diffused in other cultures, but they take longer time, or some of the beliefs are very hard to be diffused in another culture. But although they, as I said, it's a matter of speed. you know, if you compare the speed of diffusion of for technological innovations is like this, and the speed of the social patterns or the customs and even the belief system is very, very slow, takes centuries, takes years, but the innovations, the technological innovations, they are adopted very, very quickly, as we see now that after,
the technological advancement taking place in the area of computer science, we are adopting very quickly. I think we are not far behind from other developed countries as far as the adoption of these technological innovations are concerned.
Okay, now we can talk the number 11. So various parts of a culture are to some degree interrelated. I brought this image just to make a little, you know, clarification. You can see the every point is integrated or interrelated to other point. If you just take one point and try to shake it, you will see that the other points, they are also shaken. So there are also vibrations in other points as well. In the last, you can see some example, computer, mobile. Take the example of mobile only. When mobile was adopted by our culture, let's say 10-15 years ago, and mobile devices, or let's say just 5-7 years ago, because the public use of the mobile was, you know, that was the era when the youngsters started. Now, it also affected many things in our culture. The use of mobile or borrowing mobile, diffusion of mobile in our culture affected many other things. Before that, the friends, then when they used to sit, they used to talk to each other, it was physical interaction and talking face to face. But now when you see 4-5 students and everyone is busy with the mobile, so that use of mobile in our culture has affected on the other cultural habit that was there, but affecting that. The effect of mobile on relationship, effect of mobile on our quality time for our friends, for our family, for our many things. So the point here is that the parts of culture, in a specific culture, are integrated. If you touch one part, it will bring change into other parts as well. This is very important characteristics of culture, that you cannot say that if we borrow this innovation from other culture, from other society, so it will remain in that area. No, it will affect many other things that are, of course, the topic of research for the cultural experts or the studies in the area of anthropology. Here we are. The last one is the culture is a descriptive, not an evaluative concept. I hope you remember we started this topic, the concept of culture, with some definitions. And there we found out that there are definitions, there were definitions which tend to differentiate between high culture, low culture, and so on. But now there is a agreement among the scientists in this area that the culture is a descriptive, not an evaluative. We should not say that this is bad culture or this is good culture. We have no right to give these kind of adjective to the culture. It's not a value laden. Culture is a culture. There is no high versus low culture, or there is no good versus bad culture, or there is no developed versus primitive culture, or there is no advanced versus backward culture. There is no civilized or polite culture. What we can only say is that this is the culture of this particular area, and we describe it. We only give description and we don't give our judgment. So the culture, either we can say they are similar, maybe Pakistani culture is similar to or is different from. In this way we can analyze the different features of a particular culture or many cultures and compare them, but the above adjectives are not academically allowed, okay, because the academics the academic research focuses on just discovering, analyzing, describing and presenting it to the world. So with this our topic is finished, the concept of culture, and I hope that if you need repeatedly go back to the lectures, the whole lectures of course, two parts, and with your advanced reading, and I'm sure you would have a very good vivid concept of the culture that will be helping you in understanding the remaining topics of this course. Our next topic in this course is the, and this is advanced reading assignment for advanced reading, is that the relationship between culture and language. The article is not too long. I don't think it's more than 4 or 5 pages, or maybe 4 pages only. The remaining are just the questionnaire. So go through that article for the next lecture, and have a good day and good week ahead, and please follow my instructions. Thank you very much. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu.